Welcome to this week's service of the Ministry of the Word for the second Sunday after the Epiphany. Just before our monthly vestry Zoom meeting was called to order, one of our members quipped to the group, "If 2021 came with a 14-day guarantee, I think all of us would be asking for our money back." Now, like any good joke, this one has some deep and uncomfortable truth in it for us. Many of us, myself included, continue to be unsettled by the state of our world in general, and more specifically, by the recent turmoil in our nation. I think the part that unsettles me the most is that much of the turmoil that has been simmering for the past many, many months and came to full and violent boil on January 6th has been done in the name of Christianity. And for those with little or no experience of our faith, or those who carry an abiding cynicism about our faith, this is all too often their experience of us. This is what they see. And this, of course, is in spite of the fact that the gospel we proclaim is contrary to many, many, many of the things that we have seen and heard. And this is precisely why it's so important, the things that we do on this day. For when we gather, even as a virtual community of faith, we gather to praise and to bear witness to the God who is pure and unbounded love, the God whose wondrous name is love, the God whose very purpose is love, and we seek to show forth God's love in our own lives and for the sake of the world. That is the Christianity we know and understand. For we gather as followers of Jesus, the Prince of Peace, the one who, as that wonderful morning prayer collect says, stretched out his loving arms on the hard wood of the cross so that the whole world might come within the reach of his saving embrace. Our time together is important, especially in times like these, especially in troubling times, so that we can be strengthened and encouraged in our own discipleship as we continue to strive to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly in God's world, knowing that it is only love that can save us. That is the message that the world is hungry to hear. That is what we do. That is who we are. Let us now pause. Take a deep breath, open our hearts and minds to hear and receive the living word of our living and all-loving God. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Right on, right on, great.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whose Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, is the light of the world, grant that your people, illumined by your word and sacraments, may shine with the radiance of Christ's glory, that he may be known, worshipped, and obeyed to the ends of the earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Samuel. Now the boy Samuel was ministering to the Lord under Eli. The word of the Lord was rare in those days. Visions were not widespread. At that time, Eli, whose eyesight had begun to grow dim so that he could not see, was lying down in his room. The lamp of God had not yet gone out, and Samuel was lying down in the temple of the Lord where the ark of God was. Then the Lord called, "Samuel, Samuel." And he said, "Here I am," and ran to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. Lie down again." So he went and lay down. The Lord called again, "Samuel." Samuel got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." But he said, "I did not call. My son, lie down again." Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord, and the word of the Lord had not yet been revealed to him. The Lord called Samuel again a third time, and he got up and went to Eli and said, "Here I am, for you called me." Then Eli perceived that the Lord was calling the boy. Therefore Eli said to Samuel, "Go, lie down, and if he calls you, you shall say, 'Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening.'" So Samuel went and lay down in his place. Now the Lord came and stood there calling as before, "Samuel, Samuel." And Samuel said, "Speak, for your servant is listening." Then the Lord said to Samuel, "See, I am about to do something in Israel that will make both ears of anyone who hears of it tingle. On that day, I will fulfill against Eli all that I have spoken concerning his house from beginning to end. For I have told him that I'm about to punish his house forever for the iniquity that he knew, because his sons were blaspheming God, and he did not restrain them. Therefore, I swear to the house of Eli that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be expiated by sacrifice or offering forever." Samuel lay there until morning. Then he opened the doors of the house of the Lord. Samuel was afraid to tell the vision to Eli. But Eli called Samuel and said, "Samuel, my son." He said, "Here I am." Eli said, "What was it that he told you? Do not hide it from me. May God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all that he told you." So Samuel told him everything and hid nothing from him. Then he said, "It is the Lord. Let him do what seems good to him." As Samuel grew up, the Lord was with him and let none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was a trustworthy prophet of the Lord. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Let us pray a portion of Psalm 139 together. Lord, you have searched me out and known me.
You know my sitting down and my rising up. You discern my thoughts from afar.
You trace my journeys and my resting places.
And are acquainted with all my ways.
Indeed, there is not a word on my lips.
But you, O Lord, know it all together.
You press upon me behind and before.
And lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me.
It is so high that I cannot attain it to it.
For you yourself created my inmost parts.
You knit me together in my mother's womb.
I will thank you because I am marvelously made.
Your works are wonderful and I know it well.
My body was not hidden from you.
While I was being made in secret and woven in the depths of the earth.
Your eyes beheld my limbs, yet unfinished in the womb. All of them were written in your book.
They were fashioned day by day, when as yet there was none of them.
How deep I find your thoughts, O God.
How great is the sum of them.
If I were to count them, they would be more in number than the sand.
To count them all, my lifespan would need to be like yours.
Reading from John. Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him about whom Moses in the law and the prophets also wrote, Jesus of Joseph from Nazareth." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come from Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." When Jesus saw Nathanael coming towards him, he said of him, "Here is truly an Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael asked him, "Where did you get to know me?" Jesus answered him, "I saw you under a fig tree before Philip called you." Nathanael replied, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered, "Do you believe because I told you that I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Very truly, I tell you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I speak to you in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. My daughter Maya was the New Year's Eve party planner at my house. She brainstormed activities and wrote them on little pieces of paper to put inside a bunch of balloons. Every half an hour, we were supposed to pop a balloon and do whatever it said inside. So at about 7 o'clock, we popped our first balloon. "Sing Christmas carols," it directed us. And so a few of us gathered happily around the piano and sang our favorite carols. At 7:30, we popped the next balloon. "Make New Year's resolutions." We all groaned. No one wanted to do it. Truth be told, I've never been a big New Year's resolutions fan. Every year, I end up with pretty much the same ideas that I don't stick with for very long. But I think this time, it was more that I didn't think I needed to make resolutions. 2020 was a rotten year, but 2021 was going to be totally different. Vaccinations would allow us to be with our loved ones. Our political mess would heal. Our kids would go back to school. This new year was going to be so full of light and joy that thinking about resolutions just seemed negative. But 2021 has not lived up to my expectations. COVID rates are going up and vaccinations are too slow. More people are losing jobs and mourning lost friends and family. A violent mob took over the seat of our democracy, and there are more threats of coming violence in days ahead. Add to that that my daughter has been wrestling with health issues, and plans for going back to school seem to be on an endless pause. This new year feels much darker than I had hoped. But strangely enough, maybe this is the place for opportunity, because darkness is so often where we are able to see the light of God shining most brightly. Here we are in the bleak midwinter. The shepherds have left the manger. The angels have stopped singing their glorias. The magic and mystery of Christmas seems to be ebbing away, and the world seems in danger of taking control. Here we are in the season after Epiphany. After the light has made its way into the world at Christmas, but before we can be sure of what will happen next. In literary terms, an epiphany is that moment in the story where a character achieves a new realization after which everything is seen through the prism of this new light. Some people get epiphanies with a big E that completely change their lives in obvious ways. Like the burning bush that transformed Moses into a leader and liberator of the people. Or like the angel messenger with big plans for Mary that turned her from a no-name teenager with a simple life into the mother of God. Some people get obvious and indisputable epiphanies, clear signs that would convince anyone. But I think most of us probably don't. Most of us are more likely to experience subtle, small e epiphanies that make sense only to us, and sometimes only in retrospect. But those are worthy epiphanies too, and they can also be enough to give us a new prism to see things differently. Though they can be awfully easy to miss. For most of us, it's hard for God to catch our attention, like Samuel. Samuel was in a sleepy haze when a voice called his name. 3 times Samuel assumed it was his mentor Eli calling, the only person nearby. It didn't occur to Samuel that God might be trying to communicate with him. And like Nathaniel. Nathaniel was living his normal life, and along came Philip raving about this Jesus. But Nathaniel was skeptical. Can anything good come out of Nazareth? How could someone from a place so ordinary matter? And like me, most of the time I'm living my life without noticing much of what goes on around me, moving on to the next thing on my to-do list without stopping to appreciate this moment right here. Not often particularly focused on looking for God or listening for God. And maybe like you too. Now, luckily for Samuel, God didn't stop calling. God called and called and called until finally Eli recommended that Samuel respond to God, that he was listening. And when Samuel gave it a try, he discovered that the voice that had previously been just a voice was actually God's voice. Luckily for Nathaniel, Philip ignored the insult about Jesus' hometown and suggested he come along and see for himself. And despite his skepticism, Nathaniel put foot in front of dubious foot until he made his way to Jesus. And when he learned that Jesus had seen him under the fig tree, he recognized that the man who had previously been just a man was something so much more. There's a lot that is remarkable about these call stories, but it's this fig tree bit that really intrigues me. What was it about the fig tree that was so significant that it changed everything for Nathaniel to have Jesus mention it? What was Nathaniel doing or thinking under that tree? But as much as my nosy curiosity would love to know, I think the very absurdity of the fig tree is the glory of the story. We have no idea what that fig tree meant to Nathaniel, and neither did Philip or anyone else who might have been gathered around that day. To us, it seems insignificant and silly. But Jesus knew, and in that knowing, Nathaniel realized that Jesus had seen him in a real way, that Jesus knew him to the core of his being. I've been working with a small e epiphany over the last few weeks, one that has made me feel known too. On January 5th, a seminary classmate offered star words to friends over Facebook. Each year she makes stars for parishioners, each with a different word on it. The idea is that, like wise magi following the star to Jesus, each star word might be a gift to help guide someone during the year, to think about how God might be speaking through that word. And when she has extra words, she offers them to her Facebook friends. Last year, I received a great word from her, gentleness. I took it as God's invitation to be gentle with myself, to find more space for Sabbath rest, to try to incorporate more gratitude into my life, and ideally to be gentler with others too, especially those with whom I disagree. It was a lovely addition that I think helped me prepare for a less than lovely and certainly less than gentle year. And so I was quick to respond when I saw Allison's invitation this year. I definitely could use some more gentleness in my life. But this year, my word was not so easy and light. This year, my word was sacrifice. Really, God? That wasn't the kind of word I was hoping for. This year of all years, haven't we had enough of sacrifice? Not seeing loved ones, not going to school or church, scratchy masks and fogged up glasses, canceled vacations, fear and sickness and death. We have sacrificed plenty. Thank you very much. Ugh, I wrote to Allison in response, hoping to exchange my word for something a little lighter. I think this one maybe hits a little too close to home. And she wrote back, very priestly of her, "It's really hard when our word is challenging. I can't wait to hear how God works through your discomfort." The problem was, I didn't even want to sit with the word and give it credence. I didn't want to find out how God might work through my discomfort. I wanted to delete that word and rewind back to gentleness. And yet, there was also a part of me that suspected my reaction might mean that it was the right word for me after all, that I had something to learn this year about sacrifice. And sure enough, try as I might to push it aside, the word kept resurfacing. And the longer I sat with it, the gentler it became. I thought about Jesus, giving his life as a sacrifice. And not just in his death, but in his whole way of living every day, not out of a grudging resentment or a need for power, but out of love and a desire to bring every person into God's embrace. For Jesus, sacrifice wasn't a bad word. It wasn't a reminder of pain and hardship. It was a self-offering, a gift. Maybe shifting my understanding of sacrifice can change my attitude toward the hard steps still ahead. Maybe there are things I need to learn how to sacrifice in order to live more fully and lovingly, like my need to be right, and my need to be understood, and my need to have a clue what the future holds, and to be assured that everything will be all right. What would it mean to sacrifice some of these things that I hold on to so tightly? Not as punishment, but as gift to myself and to others. Maybe this word can help to bring light out of darkness with Jesus by my side. And suddenly, there I was, like Nathaniel, under the fig tree. Even if it wouldn't make sense to another living soul, I know that God was reaching out to me with that star word, inviting me to a new way of looking and listening, inviting me to a new beginning. God had turned my discomfort into meaning, spoken to me in a way I wouldn't have expected or asked for, seen me deeply, and called me forth in love. Slowly, surely, despite the darkness all around, the light that began in the manger has been flowing out into the world. The light that was just a hint on the horizon, only visible to a few, has begun to take over the sky in all kinds of surprising colors. This light has the power to warm human coldness and bring hope to lost souls. And this light shows us who we really are, full of light ourselves, just like Jesus, light that can help call others out of darkness and despair. So maybe some New Year's resolutions are in order after all. To accept the invitation that wasn't just for Nathaniel, but for all of us. Come and see. And to show my readiness with the words that aren't just for Samuel, but for all of us. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. And to do the work that is certainly for all of us, to help bring Christ's light into the darkness of this world of ours. I speak to you in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us now proclaim our faith and say, we believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father. God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the church and for the world. Grant, Almighty God, that all who confess your name may be united in your truth, live together in your love, and reveal your glory to the world. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear our prayer.
Guide the people of this land and of all nations in the ways of justice and peace, that we may honor one another and serve the common good. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear our prayer.
Give us all a reverence for the earth as your own creation, that we may use its resources rightly, in the service of others, and to your honor and glory. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear our prayer.
Grant, bless all those whose lives are closely linked with ours, and grant that we may serve Christ in them and love one another as God loves us. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear our prayer.
Comfort and heal all those who suffer in body, mind, or spirit. Give them courage and hope in their troubles, and bring them the joy of your salvation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear our prayer.
We commend to your mercy all who have died, that your will for them may be fulfilled, and we pray that we may share with all your saints in your eternal kingdom. Let us pray to the Lord.
Hear our prayer.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation.
In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church of Australia. In the Diocesan cycle of prayer, we pray for the Charlottesville region churches. We pray for all those in need of God's healing in mind, body, and spirit, especially Ruth Ann, Dee Dee, Leslie, Adeline, Tom, Elizabeth, Margie, Alexandra, Rick, Ethan, Michaela, Helen, Tony, Harrison, David, Aftab, Tracy, Alyssa, Margot, Beverly, and Sophia. We pray for all who have died, especially W.E. Rabbi, Ian Weatherly, Eugene Lauren Tilton, Della Christine Delpino, William Forsyth Dortleman, James Russell Henry, Ted Wayne Odell, Craig Keith, Brian D. Sicknick, and Howard Livengood. We give thanks for the many blessings of life, and especially for the home baptism of Bennett William K., son of Stephanie and David K.
In this time of pandemic, we pray for all those who have died of the coronavirus. We pray for all who are sick and those who care for them and for those who's most vulnerable to its spread. We pray for all who put their own lives at risk to provide for our needs. We pray for scientists and doctors working on vaccines and therapies. We pray for those working and learning in new ways, and for those who have been furloughed or are unemployed. We pray for all who are suffering from loneliness and anxiety.
We conclude our prayers by singing the St. Paul's Children's Prayer.
New morning with its light, for rest and shelter of the night, for health and food, for love and friends, for every gift your goodness sends, we thank you, gracious Lord. Amen. We thank you, gracious Lord. Amen.
Let us now confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen.
Captain of salvation.
Let us now pray in the words that our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Go on your way this day in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast to that which is good and of God. Render to no one evil for evil, but on the contrary, bless them. And the blessing of God, the Almighty and all-loving Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always. Amen.